team, and we're very pleased that Mitchell CEO and Bill Washington is here with us today. But before we get to him, I want to thank our other sponsors, Eulinger, Nami, and Allen, Sorrell Associates, King Ishario, and Alfred Media. Also, as a reminder, we'll have a raffle at the end of the program. Two gift certificates to the Stone Fire Grill. So if you can drop off your business card, make sure you do that. And make sure that you're present if you want to win. With that, I would like to call up our other presenting sponsor, and who's going to introduce our speaker, and that's Jaime de la Vega, for a senior VP of the Economy Dow. Please,
Thank you, Jason. Welcome to VICA's Second Biggest Forum of 2016. Today we'll hear from arguably one of the most important public sector executives in Los Angeles, Metro CEO, Bill Washington. As you know, Bill has a very impressive resume as a successful leader. I know everybody wants me to read his resume for the next 3 minutes. Well, write this down. You can read all about Bill at metro.net/about/board. His photo's right there. You can click on the link and find out everything he's done in his life. The question we should be asking is, why should VICA care about Bill Washington? Why does he matter to VICA? I would argue that more than any other public policy issue, transportation touches everybody in this region. And Metro is the biggest, richest, and most influential public agency in this region, planning, financing, building, and operating transportation systems here in LA. And overseeing Metro, as you know, is a part-time board of the most powerful elected officials in this region. Now, the intersection of politicians is fascinating, unique, and Bill will probably tell you it presents special challenges, right, Mr. Washington? Special challenges that have not been seen in any other local governing board. Bill also matters because his ability to guide this diverse board is going to be instrumental to the future of this region and the transportation system we see. What Metro accomplishes will directly impact how long it takes you to get to work, how quickly you can deliver your goods and services to your customers, and how your workers get to and from their jobs. More broadly, Metro is going to determine what your travel choices are in the future, not just for you, but also your children and future generations. As many of you probably read last week, Metro released a draft plan for a new sales tax measure. The board is expected to put this on the ballot perhaps in June, Phil. We'll see. And I think, as you know, developing any Metro plan is really the art of sausage making. And the process is always this strange intersection of technical analysis, public lobbying, and behind-the-scenes political jockeying. Although I don't think Bill's going to comment on the behind-the-scenes part. In military terms, reading political tea leaves is closest to what we call a WAG. And Phil can tell you what that is, or you can Google that one, too. As you know, the Valley's population is 1.8 million people, a very large voting block for a countywide sales tax measure. So the question is, does the Valley matter? Does VICA matter to Metro? I guess the answer is yes. When you look at Measure R in 2008, 40,000 votes. That was the margin of victory for the sales tax measure. You look at 2012, 16,000 votes. That was the margin of defeat for Measure J, which sought to accelerate all the Measure R projects. I think it's clear that the Valley support and VICA support for the sales tax measure is super important. As one former mayor and Metro board member who I worked for used to say, a day away from Metro is like a month in the country. So Phil's been here 383 days. That seems like 32 years of tranquility in the country. Luckily for us, Phil has chosen the less tranquil path and a more noble one to lead Metro. So please join me in welcoming Bill Washington.
Thank you. thank the sponsors, all of you, for sponsoring this event, having me here, and having Metro here. Ann Kerman is here as well. She's, I think a lot of you know her. She's a faculty member of our team. Let me just start my comments by saying that I've been here about 11 months, and when I came here, one of the first things I did was lay out a vision for where I thought the organization should be going. And I gave that vision statement to the internal employees of the agency. And before I knew it, that vision statement was like in public restrooms, and, you know, hanging on fences and stuff, you know, that one-page document. But what it really talked about was a number of things, you know, thinking big, excellence in service and support, looking at projects that could really transform the region. And that was the mindset. And that is still the thinking as we look to see how we can transform the region through transportation. And we cannot do this, of course, without the help of all of you and stakeholders and folks all over the county. So that is what we are setting out to do. I'm going to talk a little bit first about what we're doing with our current program. I'm going to talk about the potential ballot measure that I need to talk a little bit about and what we're thinking of that. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about how we're preparing for all of this, because I think this is very important, how we're preparing for what I think will be a successful November. Now, Jaime talked about our board is going to make a decision in June whether to put this on the ballot or not. And last week we did unveil a draft expenditure plan that's got a lot of stuff in it. And I'll talk just a little bit about the projects in the valley here as well. But we're very, very excited about it. First, we have four major transit projects under construction right now. We opened one of them, the Gold Line Extension, on March the 5th. We're going to open the Expo line on May the 20th. We are reaching the halfway point of the Crenshaw line, and we're going to celebrate that on May the 7th with a big celebration in South Los Angeles. We are under construction on the regional connector, and we were just talking about the regional connector at the table here, how that is going to be a game changer. That relatively short extension, which is about 2 miles, a little less than 2 miles, will connect and allow for a one-seat ride from north to south, from Azusa all the way down to Long Beach. That is a big deal. We are in construction on section one of the Purple Line right now. Section two of the Purple Line is out on the street now for solicitation. And we will pick a contractor for that this summer. Section three, we are working on that piece. We have many projects under construction. Now, one of the things that I wanted to make sure I mention is what we're doing on the bus side as well. Because a lot of people think, well, you're building all this rail, what about the bus side and bus rapid transit and all that? Well, one of the things that we are looking to do right here at CSUN Mission College is to enhance the service out here. With regard to the schools, we are extending evening routes to correspond with the night classes. We are extending that service from Mission College to the MetroLink station. The various lines that we have out here, we're extending them to Sepulveda Pass when the Expo line opens up in May. So we're doing quite a few things out here right now, whether it's a ballot measure or not, We are enhancing the service to the colleges out as well. And it is the right thing to do, which is why we're doing it, whether it's a ballot measure or not. And so we're very, very proud of what we're doing there. I do want to say, in terms of VICA, we're proud to be a sponsor. What sponsor are we? Lady?
Not our.
One of the top sponsors, I think, of VICA. And so I want to thank and praise VICA for the longstanding support of Metro efforts and for the leadership in the Valley and the strong support out of the gate for the draft expenditure plan. And I'll talk just a little bit about that in a minute. We have a long way to go. We have a lot of work to do between now and June. That draft expenditure plan that we put out, we know there's going to be changes to it and tweaks to it. You know, this shovel-ready plan that we introduced just a couple of months ago, we are already applying that shovel-ready plan to the projects that's in that draft expenditure plan. And so when you talk about the Orange Line improvements, when you talk about completing the East Valley Transit Corridor, when you talk about a number of other things, the Sepulveda Pass, which I'll get into in a minute, when you talk about the North Hollywood to Pasadena BRT and Orange Line conversion to light rail, all of those things, we are looking at what we can do to accelerate those things that are in the draft expenditure plan right now. So we are not settling for the dates that you might see in the draft expenditure. We're looking to accelerate those. Now, we quantified the impact of the shovel-ready plan on both the transit side and the highway side. And in doing the things that we identified in that shovel-ready plan, we can accelerate the transit projects by 17 years, and we can accelerate the highway projects by 20 years. And that is a big deal. And what we're talking about, these shovel-ready opportunities vary depending on the project. And so what we are in the process of doing is, if we have a project that needs an alternative analysis, then we're pushing that forward. So it varies. And so we're doing a number of things, for example, on the Orange Line improvements, so grade separations, things that we can do right now to do that, and so we are in the process of doing that. When we started thinking, probably about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, before I got here, the LA Metro Board asked staff to use a bottoms-up approach, to this potential ballot measure. Go out and talk to the COGS, and ask the COGS to submit, first of all, identify and prioritize the projects in their regions, in their subregions. And so we asked last summer, shortly after I arrived here, we started engaging in earnest with the COGS. We gave them the dollar targets, both current year and year of expenditure dollar targets, and we asked them to prioritize the projects. And they did that. We gave them of September 1 to do that. We got all the projects in, and we began to do what Jaime described as the sausage making of modeling the projects and sequencing the projects. We got all that done between September and December. Our board told us a couple of things. First, they told us to look to see how we could accelerate some projects, but make sure that people did not, the other projects did not lose their place, their original positions. And so we did that. We put together some performance metrics, and we evaluated projects. And then in March, the idea was to do all that from January to March, and then do what we did last week, and that was to present the draft expenditure plan. And we did that last week, and you all have the list, and I just talked about the Operation Shovel Ready to accelerate those things, and we're looking to do that as well. And we are out here now doing community meetings, and we were talking to different people about what that plan means. And then, as I said, in June, our board is going to make a decision on whether to put it on the ballot for November or not. Our board last week unanimously approved us taking it out for public review, and that was a big step. That was a big step to have unanimous approval from the LA Metro Board to take it out. Now, initially, we were looking at, and we're still looking at, a 40-year plan. And so what we're saying here is that we want to augment the current Measure R half-cent sales tax. We want to augment that with the new tax, and then also extend Measure R at the end of the 2040 period. So that's about 40 years. We also looked at both a 45 and a 50-year scenario. Now, the board didn't tell me to do that, but I just felt, you know what, I'm an aggressive guy. And we presented that to our board last week. And the idea behind that was not only being able to get more projects done in a 45 or a 50-year scenario, but in terms of bonding capacity and those kinds of things, the longer you go out, the possibility of accelerating projects with more bonding capacity is a real possibility. And so our staff recommendation is 50 years. Now, you can get additional projects done. You can also look to have more bonding capacity to accelerate the projects that we are identifying as well. So if you hear about that staff recommendation, we indeed recommended a 50-year scenario. We also had some new areas. We have some new areas in this new measure that were not in Measure R that we think are very important. One is state of good repair. State of good repair, we don't want to be, and these are my friends, so I'm not talking ill about them, but we don't want to be WMATA in Washington, right? Where they have tremendous state of good repair issues and asset management issues, where in other places where you can build shiny new projects, but you do not allot money to manage those assets. And so the idea behind this 2% slice, in proposed 2% slice in this new ballot measure, is state of good repair. And we're very adamant about that. The other new area we put in was paratransit services, or ADA, for the disabled. We put that in, we carved that out into this ballot. It was not in Measure R. We have an aging population. None of you, of course. But we have an aging population all over the country. Those paratransit services are growing and growing. And I have to say that as they grow around the country, they take money away from the fixed route service that you see out there, the regular routes. Because this, the ADA law is over 25 years old. It was put into law in the 90s, and it was an unfunded mandate, which is much of what the government does, right? Unfunded mandates, and transit agencies around the country are taking a big hit over this because they don't really have dedicated funds to do it. It's coming out of normal operations. And so the thought was to carve out, in this case, about 2% for ADA and paratransit services. So that is in that proposed ballot measure. We also have active transportation. We carved that out as well. Active transportation, bike paths, all those kinds of things. There are bike path projects in the San Fernando Valley here as well that is on the list here for in terms of projects. And so we carved these new areas out, and then we also increased local return. And so the local return piece is about 16%. It was 15% in Measure R. And what I've explained to different mayors around the county is this new measure, or this new tax, would start on July 1, 2017. That's when it would start. And in the case of local return, you're really looking at an additional 16% on top of the Measure R, 15%. And that is significant. There is a lot of infrastructure work to be done, not just in the big projects, but also sidewalks and gutters and everything else. And so we're covering all of that. We put a provision in to cover the green streets, the stormwater piece that is mandated now for cities around the county. And we also put opportunities for local active transportation or bike paths and things like that in your local cities. So this measure, I believe, is very, very comprehensive. It is balanced. What we have said is that we want to build a balanced system, a system that includes buses, trains, bikes, sidewalks, connectivity, access to employment centers from disadvantaged communities, opportunities for small and minority businesses. This, I believe, lifts all boats for generations to come. And, you know, I was talking to some people just yesterday, and we knew, you know, I call this sort of shock and awe from my military experience, but we knew there would be shock and awe when people looked at the list and maybe some projects are way out, you know. Maybe some projects are in the last 10 years and things like that. We knew that there would be some shock and awe to that. But what I said to this group yesterday is, you know, we are opening up projects now. We'll open up projects in the first 15 years, the second 15 years, the last 10 years. And so while we will enjoy and take advantage of this infrastructure, like we're doing with Measure R projects right now, we'll do this for the next 40, 45 years. And how about thinking about leaving our children what I call an infrastructure inheritance? Because in the 30s and 40s, you know, our infrastructure forefathers knew they could not build the interstate highway system in 5 years. Maybe not even in their lifetimes, but they had an obligation and a passion to build infrastructure thinking about their kids and grandkids. And so, yes, there's going to be some projects that are a little bit out, because if you're dependent on sales tax revenue, you can't build everything at once. But there should be some type of feeling of responsibility, I think, with our generation, that we're leaving an infrastructure inheritance for our children. And I'm very, very passionate about that. I'm a big military history buff, and I oftentimes tell the story of a young lieutenant in 1917. This young lieutenant, second lieutenant, which is the lowest rung for officers, you know, the butter bar. And this young lieutenant was taking part in a convoy from Washington, D.C. to California. And the thought was that the Army would prove to people that they could convoy across the United States with a bunch of trucks and jeeps and all of that. Well, they got about 30 miles outside of Washington. And before they left, listen, they had bands, and you know, people jumping up and down, you know, they had all of this stuff. And 30 miles outside of Washington, all the vehicles broke down. And you know why they broke down? Because the roads were terrible. And they could not get as far as they thought they could, as quick as they thought they could. It took them much longer to get to California. They got there, but it took them probably triple the time they thought. And that second lieutenant in 1917 was Dwight David Eisenhower. Mm-hmm. Now, it took him 40 years to be in a position to initiate the interstate highway system. And when he initiated the interstate highway system, he knew it wouldn't get done during his term of office. Because sometimes infrastructure build-outs do not correspond with a four-year elected official's term. Interstate highway system finally got done long after he left the presidency. And he knew it would, but he was adamant about leaving an infrastructure inheritance. And so when we talk about an expansion program, and we talk about how you're going to fund an expansion program, that being, in this case, a sales tax measure, you can't collect all you need in 1 year. And so you can't build all you need in 1 year. And so I would encourage us to think about that aspect of an infrastructure inheritance, while at the same time we are opening up projects that folks can benefit from now. That's why I started my talk with what we're about to open up. And people back in 2008 on Measure R, they looked at the package and they said, man, 2016 is a freaking long way off. But now, we got five projects under construction. And so, yeah, you might be 10 years older, but you're about to use those things. And so the idea of investing in our infrastructure, I think, is very, very important. And I was talking to the Secretary of Transportation, Anthony Fox, a couple of weeks ago. And I was telling him, and I was really preaching to the choir, but I was telling him that, you know, this country has been on what I call an infrastructure vacation for the last three decades. We have not taken care of the infrastructure that was left to us. When you talk about asset management, state of it, we have not taken care of it, and we have not built new infrastructure. When you look in Flint, Michigan, at rusted out pipes, that is infrastructure. And so we need to be very, very diligent, and we're trying to be that way right now as we trot out this measure. The last couple of things I'll talk about is some of you all were at our industry forum last month. That industry forum brought almost 600 people from all over the world. And the industry forum was designed to convey to the private sector that this region is open for business when it comes to infrastructure. That we want to be and are about to become the infrastructure capital of the world. When you look at a potential ballot measure that we're introducing, when you look at the NFL coming to town and about to build a $2 billion stadium, when you look at the possibility of the Olympics coming, when you look at the World's Fair, I think in 2022, we are about to become the infrastructure capital of the world. Ain't nobody else doing it. This is a big deal. And so that industry forum was designed to say to the private sector, we're open for business. We introduced an unsolicited proposal policy at that forum. And that unsolicited proposal policy was designed to say to the private sector, you don't have to wait for us to put out an RFP. Because what, I mean, the public entities, the private sector, they are totally reactive to us. You wait for us to put out an RFP, you answer the RFP, we review the RFP, we select. What we're saying with the unsolicited proposal policy is don't wait for us, you bring your ideas to us. We'll identify it, we'll evaluate it, we will determine whether it has technical or financial merit, and if it does, we're going to put it out or we'll sole source it. We created an Office of Extraordinary Innovation. Dr. Joshua Shank is leading that up. he's leading that effort on unsolicited proposals. So there are very little rules to this in my mind. We can make them up. I ain't talking about doing nothing illegal. But when it comes to the infrastructure that we have to build, we need to be bold and we need to be aggressive. And that is what we're doing. So I will stop there. I don't know whether there were